Good morning. God is good and all the time. God is good indeed. It's been an eventful week. Amen. A lot going on. Yeah, it has been. I'm glad all of you chose to be with us in the house of the Lord this morning. My name is Michael Bingham. I'm the pastor at St. Mark Church. In the name of Jesus Christ, I welcome you to our fellowship. I have a few announcements I would like to call your attention to. Now, we do have disaster relief ongoing. United Methodist Committee on Relief is doing much to help out. There are some things that we can do. We can pray, of course. Also, you can give financially. So if you give money, that money will go directly to the victims of these disasters that have affected really, you know, Texas, Florida, much of the Southeast U.S., and also the Caribbean and the Methodist Church in each of those places. You can make disaster relief kits. We do have one five-gallon bucket out there. We did earlier a family a cleanup kit, so if you'd like to take a look at that. We would like to collect the completed kits. That's our goal, and we'll probably do that for about two more weeks and then deliver those, so please be mindful of that. Also, you can go. If you're interested in going on a relief trip, I have had a couple of people come forward and talk to me a little bit about that, so if you're interested, you got any interest at all, let me know, and we'll see if we have enough people or we can tap into a, you know, if we don't go, if we don't sponsor a team, then perhaps we can tap into another church's team. There'll be plenty of that going on, so let me know if you're interested. Also this week on Thursdays at 7 p.m. we have our grace group, so please be mindful of that. And then our Bible study, we're really going to kind of kick that off this coming week at 7 p.m. in the conference room, so we hope you'll join us for that. I know this last week's kind of hard, but so join us for True Spirituality as we look into what it means to be really a Christian, which is described very plainly and openly in Romans chapter 12. So I hope you'll join us for that. And now, what about birthdays, anniversaries, as we celebrate life and covenant? Do we have any celebrations at this time? All right, seeing none, let's center down on what's important as we worship the Lord in spirit and truth. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we give thanks to you for this day and this opportunity to be in your house. We pray, O Lord, that you bless us through the power of the Holy Spirit, with your mighty presence and the presence of your Son, Jesus, that we might worship you in spirit and truth and go forth from this place to be a blessing in the world. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing our call to worship, which is surely the presence, and our hymn of praise, Lord, I lift your name on high. Our affirmation of faith this morning is the Apostles' Creed. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Will the children come forward for children's time? Hey. Good morning. Good to see you this morning. It's good to be with you. I want to talk to you for a minute about these flowers right here. Do you know why we put flowers in the church on Sunday morning? No? You ever thought about that? It's sort of the same reason why I wear this robe right now that I'm wearing and why you are dressed in nice clothes today. We put flowers here in the church to remind us about Jesus rising from the dead. You see, the flowers represent new life or beauty. And so we see these beautiful flowers reminded of the new life or the resurrection of Jesus. And that's the same reason I wear this robe. So that's part of the reason why I wear a robe. This is a way of, by the clothing that I'm wearing, about showing what it is that I'm doing as pastor. I'm going to preach here in a few minutes and leading the church and the worship service. I wear this robe to show that. And you're wearing nice clothes. We wear our nice clothes to show that as Christians, we have new life in Jesus Christ. And so that's why we wear nice clothes, that's why we have flowers, that's why I'm wearing a robe. And in a few minutes, for those of you who don't go to children's church, I'll preach a little bit about that, about being clothed with the power of the resurrection. So we have that power, and you have Jesus in your heart, okay? So you pray after me. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, and thank you for clothing that reminds us of his gift. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you can go with Miss Elizabeth's Children's Church if you like, if your parents want that for you. Sorry, my clothing about ripped my neck off. Apologize. Okay, what God sightings do we have today? We'd like to celebrate God's activity in our lives and the world around us. Seeing none. All right. So as we come now at our time of prayer together, this week I know with the storm, I know that Bob and Sally lost a window. They were explaining to me Linda had water in her house. The Linkers and Sundays had water at their place in their house again. I don't know. I'm not trying to leave anyone out, but those are the people that are with us that I'm aware of that had some significant damage or impact from the storm. But we're alive. We are here today. My mother used to say, count your blessings, which would usually when something bad had happened, and it irritated me when she said that. So I say to all of you, count our blessings, as my mother used to say. And in all seriousness, it does bring home to us that we are blessed. And my sermon today is about that. But we're mindful of those who had much more severe impacts from this storm. Homes destroyed, lives lost. The Caribbean was terribly affected. If you're a storm a tracker like I am, you know that Maria is even now following in Irma's path. And as we're gathered here this morning to worship the Lord, hurricane watches and warnings are going out through the Leeward Islands. These islands were just devastated. And it looks like another major hurricane may come calling. And so terrible times, very difficult times. So let's be mindful of that and as we pray for one another. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and holy God, we are mindful today of our blessings and that we were kept safe in limb and body and our lives in the midst of the storm that struck Charleston. And Lord, we're mindful of communities that were not as blessed, that had great difficulty and tremendous impacts, and for families and people who lost lives or lost all their possessions. And so, Lord, our hearts go out to them, and we pray that you would bless them. And we pray for those that are working now to help them in their recovery efforts. We pray, O Lord, for those that are even now in the path of a storm that is bearing down upon them, that you would shelter them in the palm of your hand and protect them. We pray, O Lord, for you to pour forth your Spirit upon us gathered here, that we might feel the blessing of your presence and the blessing of the presence of the risen Christ. And we pray, O Lord, that you empower us through your Holy Spirit to go forth from this place, eager to share the good news, eager to give an answer for the hope that we have, and help us to always cling to that hope and cling to you as we cling to the risen Christ. For it's in his name we pray as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us offer unto God his tithes and our offerings. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, for all with which you've blessed us. Receive now these, your tithes and offerings, and bless them to do your work in the world. In the name of the risen Christ we pray. Amen. Our hymn of preparation is Open Our Eyes. Let's sing to the glory of God. Please be seated.
Morning.
Morning.
please join me in the prayer of illumination. Lord, open our minds by the power of your Holy Spirit.
That as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with transforming joy what you say to us today. Amen.
I'll be reading from Luke chapter 24, verses 44 to 53. He said to them, this is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, this is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witness of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised. But stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. Then he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany. He lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they stayed continuously in the temple praising God. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Marilyn. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we have read this, your word, help us to be hearers of the word, to know that we are blessed. And they go forth to be a blessing to others through the power of the resurrection. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's a poem by Robert Service that begins, "There are strange things done in the midnight sun by the men who toil for gold. The Arctic trails have their secret tales that would make your blood run cold. The northern lights have seen strange sights, but the strangest they ever did see was that night on the marge of Lake LaBarge, I cremated Sam McGee. I learned that poem because of the influence of a man upon my life. His name was Al, and Al was working at YMCA Camp Ocoee the first year that I was there as a counselor in training. And our trainers, those that were teaching us how to be counselors, took us out on a rock climbing and rappelling trip, a camping trip that we went on. And we camped up on Star Mountain, and so that night we stayed around a campfire. That's where Al recited the cremation of Sam McGee. I knew a stanza of it, and he was astonished that I knew that much. That he motivated me later. I learned the poem and others in its entirety. And, you know, that really influenced me. Al was sort of this character that I sort of really admired. He'd lived in the bush up in Alaska. He was an adventurer and traveled the world, and he was an amazing character. He was going to help us learn about rock climbing and rappelling. So the next morning we get up and we go around, and he takes us to this 65-foot-high cliff face, and he said, "This is a climb that I call Good Medicine Wall." So it's just good medicine to climb here. And so he said, "I'm going to lead, and I'll be the lead climber." And he turned and he looked at me and he said, "And Michael, I want you to be the second climber. Will you belay me?" And I was astonished what he was asking, and I said yes. So now the lead climber goes up first, and they place anchor points as they go. And that's the most dangerous climb, because if you place an anchor point here on the wall and then climb above that, you can fall and fall below that till your anchor catches you. And I was his belay person, which meant I was his anchor. His life, literally, was in my hands with the rope system and all this, and he was depending upon me. And so Al climbed up and got to the top, and then he sets up a different type of belay system that's safer for the young people, which would be us. And then my job was to follow him and to go up behind him. And then in addition to just climbing a rock wall, which I had never done before in my life, I had to go up and I had gear hanging off of me. I had to remove the anchor points that he had placed in the wall. And then instead of like throwing them down like I wanted to and just letting them drop on people's heads, I had to then strap them to my body. So the weight I'm carrying increases as we go up. And I was terrified. I was scared to death. So I get up almost to the top. I'm just a couple, 3 feet from the top of this rock wall. And I am literally terrified. And Al says, "Michael, stop, stop. What's your favorite flavor of ice cream?" What? And I learned, we did that at camp to sort of stop a young person who was going through something that they found to be the hardest thing they'd ever done. And in the midst of all that fear and everything, by asking them some inane question like that, it sort of gave them a moment to pause in what they were doing. And really, it kind of woke you up to what was going on. So I don't even know what I said. Might have been my favorite flavor of ice cream that time in my life. And then Al, now he's got me on the rope, and he's seated there, and he can see me. We're looking right at, we're just a few feet from each other. And like for me, to, you know, a little bit further than I am from that pulpit. And he says, "Michael, there's a rock outcropping just to your right. And if you reach up around that, I think you can find handholds. I think you can go up and around that. Why don't you do that? Don't take the easy way. Take the hard way." Now, what this meant is, if, you know, I'm on the rock wall and he's asking me to reach out behind me where I can't see and find a handhold on this rock that juts out, and then reach out with my other hand and then hang out into space as I go up and over that rock. And so I tried that. And in the middle of that maneuver, at the most risky moment in the entire climb up, my hand hit the wasp nest. I don't want to leave me hanging there for just a minute. And I'll come back to that. In our story today, now what has happened, and you need to understand a little bit about the timeline here. Jesus, this is the 40th day, or really, if you'll allow me to say this, the 43rd day that I want to concentrate on in the history of the world. Some of the 43 most important days in human history. And so what happened the 43 days ago, we had, you know, Maundy Thursday, we refer to that, and the night in which the Lord gave himself up for us. And that's where, and remember, I'm in a series of sermons here, four sermons, and on that night, Christ the Lord took bread, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. So we're at the second of these four, those four things. We are taken was last week, we are blessed. Next 2 weeks will be we are broken and we are given. So today we're going to focus on this idea of being blessed. And so on that night that Christ gave himself up for us, the next day, overnight, he was tortured and put on trial. The next day he was nailed to a cross. He died. On the third day he rose from the dead. And then for 40 days the risen Christ taught his disciples. And what we have here in Luke's gospel is this amazing story as we come to the culmination of these 40 days that Christ has been, the risen Christ, has been with his disciples. And he takes them up on a mountaintop and he lifts up his hands and he blesses them. And he tells them what's going to happen. He says, "You go and wait in Jerusalem until I give you what my Father is sending, which is the Holy Spirit." And so this amazing event, I want to think about what this means to say that we are blessed. The Lord Jesus Christ lifted up his hands and he blessed his disciples. And if you are a Christian, if you call upon the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, then that makes you a disciple and me a disciple. That makes us a follower of Jesus. And that means, my brothers and sisters, that all the way down through the ages, you and I are blessed by the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the first and greatest blessing of all, Jesus loves me. You write that down in your blank on your insert. Jesus loves me. It's the song you learn as a child. Jesus loves me, this I know. That is the first and greatest blessing of all. It is, after all, my brothers and sisters, the reason that Christ the Lord came. It is the reason that he came to earth. It is the reason that he was sent by the Father. Jesus loves you. And that is the first and greatest blessing that you can ever have in all of your life. And when all else fails and darkness abounds and sin is alive in the world, never ever forget, Jesus loves me, this I know. This is the greatest blessing that we can receive. Now, all those years ago, on Good Medicine Wall with me hanging out there in space, and I hit a wasp nest, and the wasp comes screaming out, and one of them lands on my eyeglasses right there. It's just, and then another one is trying to land on my lips, and I'm going, and it's coming back. And I look up, and an owl who has my life in his hands is surrounded by this cloud of wasps, you know, and I can only imagine the wasps that are around me. And then something happened, I don't know what, and suddenly I was up on top of the cliff. I don't know how I got there, probably just adrenaline itself. I just vaulted. I probably used the molecules of the air to push against, I don't know. But I mean, it was just this moment, and I'm up there, and then Al and I, with these ropes around us and all this gear, we're trying to get away from the edge of the cliff, and we're swatting at wasps, and we finally get away, and you're doing that you know, thing, and then the adrenaline is, and we start giggling, and now we're laughing, and he goes, "How many times did you get stung?" And I said, I didn't get stung, man. How about you? He goes, "I didn't either." And then in that moment, you know, of utter panic and the letdown and all that that's going on, while we were away from the cliff face, and we'd already called out, people down below knew we were alive, and I looked at Al, and I said, "Why did you choose me? Why did you ask me to be second climber?" And Al said, "I don't know. You kind of look like to me you could handle it. And besides, anybody that knows Robert Service and can quote it is a pretty good guy in my book." I don't know if Al recognized in me or not, or maybe perhaps our leaders had told him, but I was at an extremely low point in my life. I had no self-worth. I didn't really care if I lived or died. And I was really low. And to think that this guy who I sort of not only admired but almost hero worshiped, this guy that was just a man among men in my eyes, that he thought I could handle it, meant more to me than words can say. It was a tremendous blessing in my life in that moment. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves you. He proves his love for us because he comes to us while we are sinners. And there on that mountaintop with the disciples, he lifts his hand and he blesses them. And he tells them of the promise that is going to be given to them, the promise of the Holy Spirit that the Father will send in his name. And then that in his name salvation will be preached first in Jerusalem, but then to all the world. Jesus says in verse 49 there that you will be clothed with power from on high. And my brothers and sisters, I want to say to you that we have been clothed with the power of the resurrection. And I want you to write that word clothed down. We have been clothed. I talked to the children in children's time about a robe that I put on or the clothes that you wear. And the clothes that we wear as Christians is the clothing of the power of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit is poured out upon us, the power of the resurrection itself. You see, the very power that formed the universe was poured out onto the world, and it was so powerful, the earth itself shook. The Roman guards were made like they were dead. The rock rolled away. A light came down, and a dead man, a man that in the southern slang was good and dead, got up and walked out of his tomb. And the risen Christ, that risen Christ was there on the mountaintop with the disciples 40 days later, blessing them. And that blessing comes down to us through all the ages so that we are blessed and we are clothed with the power of the resurrection. The great Methodist theologian Thomas Oden, Methodist theologian of the 20th century, the only one to produce a multi-volume systematic theology, said, "The Gospels do not explain the resurrection." So go read them. Go read all four Gospels. Not one word even attempts to explain the resurrection. It tells us of the fact of the resurrection, doesn't spend even a moment trying to explain it. Oden goes on, "The Gospels do not explain the resurrection. The resurrection alone explains the Gospel." You see, if you really want to understand what it means that God has given us the gift of salvation through the person of Jesus Christ, you have to understand that He was dead and now He's not. And the risen Christ is here with us. You see, this is one of the greatest unique truth claims of the Christian faith, that we aren't simply left bereft or we aren't somehow left without meaning, that we are cast adrift because Jesus is not with us. Instead, we know that Christ, the risen Christ, is here amongst us right now. And we know this to be true through the power of the Holy Spirit. We are not left wanting because Jesus is absent. We are not simply sitting back and waiting on something to happen. Instead, my brothers and sisters, we are empowered through the power of the resurrection. We are empowered to be the something that should be happening in the world right now. You and I have the power of the resurrection. If something should be different in the world, God Almighty gives us the power to be that change. We bring about that change so we don't cower in fear. We don't wait for something to happen. We are the something that ought to be happening in the world. And it ought to be happening right now. Now, I am a mystic, an unrepentant mystic, by which I believe in the mystical, miracle-working power of God. And I believe that just as Jesus raised His hands and blessed the disciples, that you and I have the power as those disciples to give that blessing out. And so if you know me, we've known each other for over a year now, and you ask me how I'm doing, I try to say I'm blessed. And I try to mean it when I say it. So when you find me on a very low day, very difficult time, I might sigh and say I'm okay, and that means it's pretty bad. But on most days, most of the time, I try to say I am blessed, and I try to mean that. And in the same way, I try to part company with people by saying, "Have a blessed day." And when I say that, I try not to simply say that like, "Hey, what's up," or "Goodbye," or "See you later," or something. I try to really convey with that statement. I try to make that prayerful in the sense that I am conveying the blessing of the Holy Spirit through me. You see, the last point I want you to write down is that we are blessed and a blessing. We are blessed and a blessing. You see, we are not blessed. Our blessing is not without purpose. Our blessing is not random. Our blessing is not an accident. Our blessing is not some happy byproduct. It is the purpose for which God sent Jesus into the world. Jesus blesses us so that we can share that blessing in a hurting world. Now, I joke around a lot about not having any humility, but what I'm about to say to you, I say with humility. What happened to me all those years ago on Good Medicine Wall, God has used that to bless literally thousands of people. Because, see, that led me through camp to have this incredible experience where God changed my life radically. My acceptance of Christ Jesus as Savior and Lord. My church had a part in that. My family had a part in that. All that. But camp really was the cherry on top, the capstone. And all that I am has been shaped by my experiences at YMCA Camp Okoye. All the rest of my teenage years, all the way up until I graduated college, I spent all the time I could at Camp Okoye. And God used that so that every sermon I preach is touched by my experiences at camp. All the things that I've done in my life as a father, as a husband, all these things have been touched and empowered by my experiences at Camp Okoye. And so God blessed me, but not randomly, not by accident. God blessed me so that I could be a blessing to others. Blessings are meant to be shared, my brothers and sisters. Blessings are meant to be shared. Now, Henry Nouwen was a priest and a teacher, a theologian, and a writer. You can't really get out of seminary today without reading some of Henry Nouwen. He lived during the 20th century, and he wrote a lot of powerful things. And I want to sort of paraphrase something he shared in a book called Life of the Beloved. And Henry's dead now, but he was working as a chaplain in a facility for severely mentally and physically disabled persons. And Henry tells a story about how one day a disabled community member named Janet came up to him and asked him for a blessing. And Henry was distracted by other things going on in his life. And so he very quickly just traced the sign of the cross upon Janet's forehead. And she said, "No." Janet protested that. "No, I want a real blessing." Henry understood then how he had been insensitive to Janet's need. And so he promised her that at their next prayer service, he would have a special blessing for her. At the end of that next prayer service, about 30 people were seated in a circle on the floor, and Henry stood up and announced, "Janet has asked me for a special blessing." He didn't really know what Janet was seeking from him, but her next move left no doubt in his mind. Janet got up and walked up to Henry and simply wrapped her arms around him. And so as he embraced her in return, her tiny form was almost covered by the folds of the robe that he was wearing as he led worship. As they held each other, Henry said, "Janet, I want you to know that you are God's beloved daughter. You are precious in God's eyes. Your beautiful smile, your kindness to the people in your house, and all the good things you do show what a beautiful human being you are. I know you feel a little low these days and that there is some sadness in your heart, but I want you to remember who you are, a very special person, deeply loved by God and all the people who are here with you." Janet raised her head and looked at him, and her beaming smile told him that she had truly understood and received the blessing. What happened next was unexpected. As Janet returned to her place, another woman raised her hand. She too wanted a blessing. She stood up and embraced Henry too, laying her face against his chest. After that, a great many more of the disabled members of the community took their turn, coming up for some sort of blessing. For Henry, the most touching moment was when one of the assistants, a 24-year-old college student, raised his hand and asked, "What about me?" John was a big, burly young man, an athlete, and Henry did the same with him, wrapping his arms around him and saying, "John, it is so good that you are here. You are God's beloved son." John looked back with tears in his eyes and simply said, "Thank you. Thank you very much." My brothers and sisters, blessings are meant to be giving away, and I am very blessed. Who needs a blessing? Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you, Miss Statham. God bless you.
Thank you.
Who here has been blessed today? All right. You have a homework assignment. You've received a blessing today. You must give it away within the next 7 days. You must give this blessing. Jesus said, it is more blessed to give than receive. So if you've received a blessing today, and I know that I have, then I look forward to the joy that I will receive when I give today's blessing away. I bet you somebody here today thought this morning when they opened their eyes, I ain't going to church today. I ain't got it in me. Ooh, I see people smiling. Yeah. And yet you came and you're able to say, I'm blessed. Do not hold this blessing in. Don't do that. Give this blessing away. That's your homework. And then we'll have God sightings next Sunday. Huh? I bet you we'll have some that'll knock your socks off. Because y'all are going to look for an opportunity to give this blessing away. Don't cheapen that. Don't just give it to the first person you see. Don't give it to me at the back door saying, here you go, preacher, take it back. Not that I don't need your blessing. But you let the Lord lead you. You let the Lord guide you. You let the Lord send you. Because Jesus, on the night he gave himself up for us, took bread and he blessed it. And he tells us that we are to be the bread of life. That we are the body of Christ. And therefore, we are blessed. So give away your blessing to the glory of God. Let us pray. Oh Lord God Almighty, you have blessed us today. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of your Son, Jesus. Thank you that through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can feel his presence here with us today. It has been a blessing to be in church today. And so, oh Lord, we pray that you would guide our steps, guide our thoughts, guide the words of our mouths, that we might be a blessing for others this week, and send us forth into this dark and hurting world to give away our blessing. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let's stand and sing, brothers and sisters. Let's sing Living for Jesus to the glory of God. Thank you. receive now this benediction. Now go out in peace and serve your God and your neighbor in all that you do. And may the blessing of Almighty God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be upon you now and evermore until we meet again. Amen.